Hello everybody and welcome to the first book review here on military aviation history. Now today we're talking about two books on the very similar topic, that being the birth of the RAF 100 years ago. First book we're going to talk about is Richard Overy's The Birth of the RAF, and the second book is Ian Philpott's The Birth of the RAF. Yes, they have the same name, do not confuse them, they're very similar books. Now before I go into the good, the bad and the ugly, when it comes to these kind of books, I'd like to thank my patrons for actually supporting me through all this endeavor here on the channel. The channel wouldn't be here without you guys, and it's really your support that allows me to buy books such as these, read them, and then of course be able to make videos from them. And in fact, I have used both books in one of my recent videos on the history of the RAF. Now, we're gonna start off with this little book here by Richard Overy, since it was the book that was only recently released. It was released a couple of weeks ago from the making of this video, March 2018. And it really coincided nicely with the centenary commemoration of the birth of the RAF 100 years ago. The RAF, of course, was established on the 1st of April 1918. And now, since we are in 2018, of course, it has its 100th birthday. This book, of course, was written for the purpose of coinciding with that event. So we have to kind of take that into account, because usually books that are written for such events are somewhat different than the other academic literature that is written throughout the years. Now, this book is organized in four chapters, and the content-wise, it is roughly 100 pages, 100 to 10 pages long. Page count itself does not mean quality or anything in that regard. However, I do want to say a few positive things about this book and then also go into some of the negative stuff, or actually just explain who this book is for and who this book is not for. Richard Overy in the book theoretically starts out in 1905 and he goes all the way to 1935. However, when you actually read through the book, you realize that the first couple of pages are really just introductory. He kind of goes into what was just before the World War, the First World War, and then he immediately starts with the operations of the Royal Flying Corps and the Royal Naval Air Service. So he really doesn't start in 1905, he actually starts in 1914. And then the last chapter goes into what happens after the RAF was established and how it essentially had to be saved or defended from the influence of the treasury, the army, the navy, and so on, and all that good stuff. So it does go also a little bit into the political discussion. Now, this book is generally what I would regard as a remix of the known, and it is not exploratory research down the alley of history. It is very much just Richard Overy, who, by the way, is a very well-known author. Most of you probably have a book of him or two, and if you do, tell us which one it is in the comments below. Tell us what you think about it as well. I, for example, really like Richard Overy's The Bombing War. So Richard Overy is a good author, and his texts usually read very well. This is no exception. It flows very nicely. You can go through it very fast. In fact, you can read through this book in an afternoon if you set your will to it. The problem with this book, in my opinion, is that for somebody who really wants to do in-depth reading on the subject, this is not the book that is for you, but it is also not written for you. This book is really written for those people that don't know much about the subject area and that now have heard that the RAF becomes 100 years old and that want to have a little bit of a history lesson. So it is a safe book. It is a simplified book. It sometimes lacks a little bit of context, especially when you compare it to Ian Philpott's book, but we'll go into that later. And that does, perhaps for the uninitiated reader, result in a somewhat skewed vision of how things were. Perhaps a little bit, how shall I say, especially when he talks about the inter-service rivalry, so the Army, Navy, and the RAF, the oversimplification that comes with simply the compactness of this book does, I think, run the risk of the reader going out of this book with the wrong conclusions, or simply not having the full picture, and perhaps it being a little bit too positive on the RAF. Although, you know, that was a very complicated history, or piece of history, or time in history as well. So this book is something that is written for the wider audience. However, it also is on sale for roughly £10 sterling, which translates, I believe, somewhere between $11 to $15 or euros or whatever your regional equivalent might be. So it's a very cheap book. As I said, very easy to read. And this might be an ideal gift for somebody that you know who is kind of interested in history, but to the point where he would go to museums and, you know, read through maybe the text of an aircraft, but he's not somebody who really does some deep reading. He kind of likes to stay a little bit on the platonic side. Yeah, there's a lot of those people that exist, and that's fair enough as well. And for those people, this book might be really nice, because it gives the history. It doesn't go into the nit and grit. It doesn't really do all that much detail work, but it does serve you nicely just as a kind of introduction to the subject. It has its limits, but if you have already done your reading, you'll realize those very quickly. And if you haven't done your reading, it still sets you up relatively nicely. I myself would not buy it again, I have to admit that. But for somebody like out there, maybe you find some interest in it. I also have a link to this book in the description below. It's an Amazon affiliate link. You can check it out there if you want. And if you buy it, you know, for yourself or your friend, I hope that you enjoy it or that your friend enjoys it. Although, as I said, I'm not the biggest fan of this book. Going on to Ian Philpott's book, The Birth of the RAF. Now, this book was, if memory serves me right, released in 2009. And it is, in my opinion, fascinating. It's a really, really good and well-structured book. However, it is also not for everybody, and I will explain that in a little bit more detail as we go through it. Now, Ian Philpott, even though it says The Birth of the Royal Air Force, Ian Philpott does not start, let's say, 1914 or, you know, just a few years before the Great War starts, like Richard Overy. No. Ian Philpott goes all the way back to the French Revolution. And just a second, just to be very British, some good old English breakfast tea there, just to keep myself lubricated. But he starts with the French Revolution, and he explains the introduction of balloons in warfare and how they were used to scout out enemy positions back in the day. And this is actually a quite nice start to the book, because it sets the scene of then what's going to happen in Britain. Because while it is, of course, the French Revolution and this stuff happens over in France, the Brits aren't sleeping, and some of them wake up to the possibilities of balloons and want to use them also in warfare. Now, because it is something new, not everybody is obviously convinced, and it takes some pioneering work to get the balloon force up and running in Britain. Sorry, I just have to take another one. That is good tea. That is really good, some good tea. Then, what is also in this book, not just the balloon force and how it was introduced to Britain against the reservations of, for example, more orthodoxly minded generals and admirals, you also have a nice little account of the British negotiations with the American Wright brothers in trying to buy a couple of their flyers. Also, again, for testing reasons, trying to ascertain the military value of lightweight flyers. And this then afterwards sets you up very nicely for the First World War. And even though, once again, the book is called The Birth of the Royal Air Force, it actually starts with the birth of, actually after the whole discussion, the setup discussion is done, it starts out with the establishment of the Royal Flying Corps and Royal Naval Air Service. So you actually get the history of those two branches in this book as well. And it then all goes on in this first part in the operations of the Royal Flying Corps and the Royal Naval Air Service. And it goes through 1914, 1915, 16, and 17. And it does a really, really nice job of breaking everything down. This book will talk to you about where the squadrons were based. It will talk to you about what the tactics were in some regard, or what the doctrine at the time was. You know, for example, the army liked to do a lot of work on the front lines, bombarding the Germans on the front lines with the Royal Flying Corps, or using it to cover their advances or their defenses and so on. Whereas, for example, the Royal Naval Air Service had a completely different task. Obviously, it had to patrol maritime seas, and then it also did some long-range bombing missions. The book also goes into the dangers that were posed by the Zeppelins and what the reaction to the Zeppelins was in Britain, how they tried to defend themselves on the home front and all that good stuff. And only after all that has been done and we're finally in 1917 and that all has been accounted for, does this book go into discussion of how the Royal Air Force was established. And here we don't just talk about the military need or the military reasons for this, but we also talk about the discussions in Whitehall. So the bureaucracy involved, who was against who was trying to make what kind of points, what kind of arguments. It goes into the Joint Air Board, it goes into the Smuts Committee, it goes into all that good stuff. And in the appendix, in fact, you also have the draft of the Air Force Bill from 1917 written there. It's just a draft, but that's kind of nice. You can actually read through it and, you know, see what kind of law they actually tried to, or what kind of bill they tried to pass there. And then the Royal Air Force is established, and then the book goes into the air operations of the Royal Air Force in the waning months of World War I. Now, you'd think that the book is done at this point because it has done its job. The birth of the Royal Air Force, the Royal Air Force is established, the war is over. What else can this book do? Well, the second part of the book, which really is, I mean, it is quite a thick book. These are roughly 150 pages with the appendix and the bibliography, right? So you can see the kind of difference here, or not just in size, but also in the thickness. The second part of this book goes into the organization of an air force. It talks about aircraft design and development. It talks about technical stuff, like, for example, even engines. It talks about the personnel. It talks about the administration. It even gives, it even talks about the training of air staff. Technical details, as I said, supply, and I believe there's a couple of more things that just I can't come up with at the moment. I'll just check it myself. And this is really nice. Of course, the airfields. The airfields where the Royal Air Force was based, and also the Royal Flying Corps and the Royal Naval Air Service. And this really makes this book not just a history book, because the first part really is kind of a history book. The second part of it is more of an encyclopedia, which is really strange and a really strange mixture, but in this book it works, because while in the first part of the book, you get what you want out of this book, The Birth of the Royal Air Force, the second part sets you really up nicely to get to understand the wider context of aviation during the First World War. Of course, from a British perspective, that makes absolutely sense, since that is what the book's topic is about. But it also gives you just a wider chance of reading and really finding something maybe that interests you. Maybe, for example, you read for this book, for the second part of this book, and you realize, oh, I'm really interested in aircraft design suddenly from the First World War. This sounds really interesting. And it gives an account of what the Brits did with their aircraft. So the Sopwith company, for example, Felixstowe and so on. And maybe it piques your interest for that kind of time period and you go into wider reading with more specialized books. However, once the second part is done, the book still isn't done. And that is because the appendix is substantial in this book. I already said the Air Force Bill, the draft Air Force Bill, has been cited. You also have a short biographical chapter on Hugh Trenchard, who's kind of a foundational character of the RAF. Very interesting character, in fact. He was very much opposed to the RAF. Then when he realized that the RAF was going to happen and he was better getting to go on board, he became the chief of the air staff of the RAF. After a couple of weeks, he was thrown out of that office for somebody named Skies. And then he came back in 1919 under Winston Churchill, with the support of Winston Churchill, I should say, and really established or developed the RAF into what it would be then for the Second World War. Very interesting character, very interesting take on what air power should achieve and what it shouldn't achieve. And it's actually quite nice that we have some facts on him in this book as well. And what it also does, this book is, and this is where, and once again, the encyclopedic part comes in, it gives an account of all the aircraft that Britain used during the time. It doesn't matter if, for example, it also has some French planes in here, because the Brits did use also French planes during the First World War. And it only gives a short paragraph on each of these planes, but it's kind of nice because the information that is out there for World War I aircraft is somewhat lacking. Yeah, there's not that many books that actually talk about this this period in time, especially when it comes to the technical stuff. And having a book like this, just even if it's just a paragraph, you know, if you, for example, notice that the book in the first part talks about a certain aircraft, let's say the Sopwith Camel, then you can go in the appendix and say, okay, what's the Sopwith Camel? Oh, it's this thing. Okay, cool. That looks nice. And you know what it is. So yeah, this is, in essence, this is a catch-all book, but not catch-all as in audience, like Richard Overy's book, but catch-all as in everything related to the Royal Air Force and British aviation during the World War, during the First World War phase, which makes this book not for everybody. I must say that if you read through this, it's not that easy to read, simply because there's so much information. It's very dense. And even though the structure is very well, I found myself sometimes flicking back a couple of pages because Ian Philpott talks about something that happened before and I just couldn't remember it anymore. So it's not especially light reading. It's not something that I would say is for somebody who hasn't actually already invested a lot of time in getting, you know, very, well, academic literature or very detailed literature on the subject area. It is not a first read book, but it is a very good book that you should keep in mind if the subject area interests you. And if it does, and if you don't feel ready for it now, right now, maybe pick it up in a bookstore, flick through the pages a little bit, see if it's for you. Overall, I think if you put your mind to it, this book will serve you very nicely. Yeah. So my recommendation definitely this book. Once again, there's a link in the description below to Amazon. It's an affiliate link. This book sells for, if I remember correctly, I think it's £35, which I guess would put it somewhere in the ballpark of 40 to 50 euros, dollars, or whatever your regional equivalent might be, which is a very good investment, I might add. Very, very good price for this book. In fact, Ian Philpott has written another book about the RAF, I believe, in the interwar years. And because this book is so good, I am going to pick that one up as well. So to conclude this, my recommendation is indeed Ian Philpott's book, The Birth of the RAF. It is for the avid reader, it is for the interested reader, it is for the detailed reader. It is really for the reader who wants to know everything that happened during that time. And if you just want a quick fix on the history of the RAF, pick up this book by Richard Overy. It's not exactly something to write home about, but it gets the job done as well. If I would have to choose, I would take this one, but the choice is up to you, so you decide. Now, thank you very much for joining me for this book review. Check out the description below for some useful links. Check out my Patreon if you want to support my channel, if you want to see more videos like this. And as always, I hope you guys have a great day, good hunting, and see you in the sky.